Good morning, everybody. Welcome. Testing 1, 2. Testing 1, 2. Testing, testing. Welcome to Living Word Community Church, everyone. Good to see you all here. It's good to be here, huh? Amen. All right, we're getting ready to do some worship. If you guys want to find your seats as you're doing your quick little meet and greet. We're going to sing a song we haven't sung in a long time. It's I Can Sing of Your Love Forever. So please join us.
Is it on? Okay. Sorry, we got a new guy up there today. We got to give him a break. Let's give up for Brandon Mestis. Thank you for bailing me out today, Brandon. I guess my kids that are up there thought they needed a vacation today, so they said, you're on your own. So I called Brandon. All right, guys, how is everybody this morning? Good morning. Good morning. Oh, man, we got Pastor Rick back. Oh, man, he looks all rested up. You see that tan? Man, he's got a great looking tan. Welcome back, Pastor. But everybody wanted me to remind you, we're happy to see you. We can't wait for your preaching, but it is Communion Sunday today. So, yeah, don't be running too long. All right, guys. Just got a few announcements. This next week, Saturday, is men's prayer breakfast. So, gentlemen, put that on your calendar. Come check it out. If you haven't joined us for men's prayer breakfast, you guys are missing out. Come check it out. It's Saturday morning at 8 a.m. right here in the church. We always have an amazing breakfast, so come join us for fellowship. We do a little bit of a devotion, so it's just a great opportunity to meet other like-minded Christian men, and it's just a good time. So come join us for that. Is there a ministry meeting? Okay, no women's ministry meeting, so ladies, you're not invited. I'm sorry. I'm just kidding. If you guys are hungry, you guys can come by. We'll give you a little bit of what's ever left over. It's good. Other than that, we're getting into the school season, so let's keep our kiddos in prayer as they enter into the school season this year. These kids got a lot going on, so we want to pray for them. In September, youth group, Kevin and I's youth group, Street Smart Christian, will start back up in September. So parents and kids out there, if you're looking for a youth group, I encourage you to come join us for that. We're going to do a little different this year. We're going to have a more structured Bible study. We're going to go over the Fundamentals of Faith by John MacArthur. It's a really good, that's how I got started in discipleship. It's a really good book, and I think it's good for all ages to go through that book. So come join us for that. We always do a 30-minute Bible study, and then we play games. Right, Talia? And, is it fun? Okay, good. She's like, oh, they're forcing me to say this. So, yeah. No, it's a good time, guys. And really, this world's getting crazier and crazier. It couldn't be a more important time for discipleship to not only start at home, but keep these kids in the Word and in the truth when we're faced with so many different obstacles and lies coming our way. So, parents, perfectly consider getting your kids involved into a youth group. And at every school, there is a program called FCA, Fellowship of the Christian Athlete. That's not only for athletes, that's for all of you high school kids to get involved in. And I am blessed to be a part of FCA. So get involved in that in all the schools. It's a really good program, and it keeps these kids in the Word, keeps them motivated, and keeps them encouraged. So prayerfully consider that, guys, because these kids are our future, and we want to lead them in the right way, especially with the craziness that is going on right now. If you have any questions about youth group, you can either get with me or Kevin. Those will be on Wednesday nights, 6:30 to 7:30, and food is provided, so we will feed those kids too, and give them a whole bunch of sugar and Red Bulls. I think we're doing Red Bulls before we send them home to make sure that their homework gets done. With that being said, I really don't have a whole lot. Oh, they're still doing the adult Bible studies, right, on Wednesday night, the couples Bible studies. So all you married couples, dating couples, people maybe looking to be a couple one day, come join Cody and Trael Wednesday nights, 6:30. That is a potluck as well, so they also have food, and they have childcare is provided. However, that is $10, right? $10 a kid. They're ignoring me because they don't want me to. I don't know how much it is, Adam. You pocket that cash. So it's, in that case, it's $25 a kid, and you make your checks out to Adam Tipton. No, it's $10 a kid. And so couples, married couples, dating couples, singles, if you're looking, you're starting to date, join those guys. They're going through a Chip Ingram Bible study. I forgot what it was called, but it's about emotions. I know that, guys. Emotion. Oh, nice. See, you're hired, Brandon. You're hired. So that's the Bible study, Emotions That Destroy. I don't know anybody. I don't have emotions, right? She's not even paying attention. So join Cody and Trail. They're such an awesome couple to come and listen to and go to that Bible study. So if you ain't got nothing to do, Wednesday night, 6:30, join those guys. Adult Bible studies. The ladies are still going strong, 8:30 in the morning on Tuesdays. If you want to join the ladies at 8:30 on Tuesday mornings, they're going through the book of Joshua, and they would love to have you ladies come join them. As far as the evening adult Bible studies, we will be starting up sometime in September. I will have more information on those Bible studies the closer we get to that. The first Tuesday in September, we will be starting the men's and women's evening Bible studies. So join us for that. That's always a good time. That's always a great study. Join us for that. Other than that, we'll jump right into our... Oh, yes. Oh, yeah. I just seen that. We have the annual Miller Stevens Barbecue on August 25th. That's a Sunday. It'll be... what time? 1 o'clock, and that will be at Rolla and Mary Miller's house. They will probably have a map to how to get to their house. It'll be on the back counter the closer we get to that date. Join us for that. That is always a really good time, an amazing barbecue. It's an awesome time to fellowship. We always have cornhole or something going on outside. It's been amazing. I've gone every year since I've been coming. They've been doing it for I don't know how long, forever. So join us for the Miller Stevens Barbecue, August 25th. Put that on your calendar. Everybody's invited to that. Come fellowship with us. Other than that, let's jump into our memory verse. I see the champion, the belt buckle wearing champion, already got his hand. Oh, did you raise your hand too? No, okay. I thought I saw you raise your hand. All right, take it away. Amen. Eric, there is a reason you got a championship belt buckle on, because you knock it out of the park every single week. And you know, he told me a secret. He doesn't go home and memorize this all week. He can do it in 15 minutes. As soon as he walks in the church, he memorizes it, and then he has it all week long. So thank you so much for that encouragement, Eric. Thank you, guys. We will see you next week.
All right, if you want to stand and join us again, we're going to continue on with some worship as we prepare our hearts for God's word. We're going to sing The Father's House.
Lay your burdens down. Breaking
As we're standing here, we do stand in awe of our mighty Lord. Let's sing this song together, Stand in Awe. Cast our cares at your feet because you care for each one of us here. Father, we look to you for our guidance, and we know that you love us and you protect us. You never leave us, you never forsake us. Father, we come to hear what you have for us today. We pray that you would use Rick greatly as he brings forth your word, that our hearts and minds and our ears are open to what you have for each one of us. And Father, we are so thankful that you brought Rick and Cheryl back safely. Father, we just thank you for this fellowship that we have and the family that we have in this church. May you bless this time. It's in Jesus' precious and powerful name that we ask these things. And everybody said, Amen. You may be seated.
Really good to be back. I appreciate the, well, I don't want to get into applause. There was a few boos, you know. That keeps you humble, and not everybody's going to like you, and that's all right. I have to please one person, and who is that? God. That's it. And please God, that's all I want to do. I appreciate the Gillermans filling in for me, tag teaming it. Thank you, Tony and Gibson. Appreciate all you've done. And Tim Mockerman, I know Tim filled in for me, and I always feel like I can leave and not worry, you know, not worrying, not in a state where I'm afraid that some wacko is going to be starting something that's erroneous or heretical. So I just appreciate the men that study God's word and want to give it out in its whole counsel. They cannot hear me? You cannot hear me? You can hear?
Repeat everything you just said.
Teresa? I love you, but I'm not going to do that. Is that good now? Are we okay? Yeah, okay. All right, okay. So anyway, it's really good to be back. And somebody said, are you rested? I said, well, you know, you miss your bed. And we're not little young guys anymore, so we are running around with our kids. And sometimes, you know, you got to keep up. So, but we're blessed. We're blessed. We're able to keep up somewhat. I'm always trying to give you some good reading material. The best reading material is your Bible. But I got this little text from my cousin the other day and says, Rick, you need to look at Megan Basham's book, Shepherds for Sale. Shepherds for Sale, Megan Basham. And you go, why Shepherds for Sale? Well, figure it out. Not a lot of gospel preaching going on in our churches. There's a lot of tickling of the ear. There's a lot of building of these great big edifices and giant churches. And we have, I guess, in this mindset that we have celebrities that are behind the pulpit. I'm not a celebrity. I'm a servant of God. And I don't want you ever look to me. I want you to look to God for your every need, the Lord Jesus Christ. But this would be a good read. Now, you say, how do you know that? Well, I've read a little bit of it. But also, I know that John MacArthur is behind this book, and Vodi Bakum, some people that I respect. This lady has done a great deal of research. It talks about critical race theory, woke, all these evolutionary ideas that the culture is being bombarded with, transgender war that we have right now, and trying to make it a-okay. All right? So, get this book if you like to read, all right? As a Christian, how am I supposed to live? I changed in midstream. I was going to give a sermon out of 2 Corinthians chapter 7 because that's where we've been for a number of months. We go verse by verse through, you know, certain books, and I love to do that, and I will always do that, even when it's topical. I will always preach verse by verse so that you can follow and know what's on my heart. It first started when somebody said, did you know President Trump was shot? Okay, that's really bad. That's terrible. Anybody being shot for their views, that's terrible. Then it went from there to, did you know they were blaspheming the Lord's Supper at the Paris Olympics? And I about blew a gasket. Transgender, 2024. Terrible. Then, I love boxing. I'm not particularly fond of women boxing, although I've seen some cat fights in my life. Don't ever try to break up girls that are fighting. You will lose your life. This man that was trying to become a woman was boxing and was beating this girl up unmercifully. Why? He's a man. I don't care how you slice it, men are stronger than women. They are. Why? Because that's how God built us. All right? That just set my hair on fire. I said, I'm not preaching on, we're going to talk about what's going on right now. And how are we going to get through this? I will tell you this, that you could move to Canada, or you could move to Texas, or you could move to Mexico. You could move to a South Sea island, and you're still going to have problems. You're not going to run away from it. And we're here for a reason, for such a time as this. Just like Queen Esther, we're here, and I'm not running, and neither are you. Now, if God calls you to move, that's fine. You do your thing. But it's not going to be any better anywhere else, because I saw it on my travels. All right? It's not going to be any better anywhere else. And I'm disturbed, but I had to get my moorings from Scripture, because if you don't, you will lose your mind. You'll go insane. God's in control, and I know that. I love the Olympics partly because, you know, one of our family members won the decathlon, won a gold medal just a little ways down the road from us. He was from Simla. You guys know Glenn Morris, and you should take pride in that too, because he's just a small town kid that won the decathlon before Adolf Hitler in Nazi Germany in 1936. I have pictures of his gold medal in my weight room, and I took that down just for a moment because I'm just sick of what's happening, you know, and nobody stands up, nobody says anything, and just like, well, whatever, this is how it's supposed to be. It's not how it's supposed to be. Everything is upside down, right? Okay, now, you're going to have to bear with me because I'm not going to get right into Philippians chapter 2 right away. So just bear with me. Isaiah 5:20. Okay? You can mark that or you can turn to that if you want. I don't care what you do. But I'm going to read this out of the Contemporary English Version. And what it says, you are headed for trouble. It says you are headed for trouble. You say wrong is right. Darkness is light, and bitterness is sweet. That's the Contemporary English Version. I really like that. You're headed for trouble. What do you see on the horizon? Bad news, and that's not CCR. We have a problem. And it's sin. Let's just call it what it is, sin. Sin is terrible. It will kill you if you don't kill it. So what are we seeing? If you're a writer, if you take notes, you can write down number one. What are we seeing? We're seeing God's judgment. We are in the latter part of His judgment. You say, how do you know that? Well, I'll take you to Romans here pretty quick. But we first see in Romans chapter 1, and we'll turn there just briefly this morning, but we saw the sexual revolution. I believe that it began in the 60s. I did some study. A lot of people said 70s and 80s. I think it continued on, but I do believe it started in the 60s. And that's when I was a teenager. And I'm telling you, man, it was like, whoa, what is going on here? Lots of immorality. Lots of sexual immorality. Nobody telling anybody that you can't do this or that. Lots of disrespect. You remember that, some of you that were living in the 60s? Lots of disrespect for authority, for parents, for police officers, for any kind of government entity. Lots of disrespect. And then we see the second issue that comes along. We'll see this in just a few minutes. Hang with me. The second point is that homosexuality comes along. We have sexual immorality. That doesn't satisfy, so we're going to go a little deeper here into depravity, and we're going to mess with homosexuality. We're with women. Men are with men. I frankly didn't know anything about that as a young man. We knew what the word queer was, and we had attached that to someone that had sexual feelings, feminine feelings for another person of the same sex, but I never really saw that. Okay, growing up, I didn't see that. Now maybe some of you did in the 60s because you were in huge cities, but I did not for the most part. And what did we see as far as judgment there? AIDS. AIDS. Are you with me? Say amen if you are. Okay. And everybody's now taking a pill or two pills so that they can escape all these diseases from a terrible sexual sin. Now we're getting some feedback. Yeah. I got your number up there. Okay. The third and final one, and that's where we're at now. And no one's going to overturn this. We are very close to utter devastation. Go, man, I'm glad you're back from vacation. Now we'll get to hear a real uplifting message, and I'll be depressed for a week. No, I'm just telling you the truth, okay? I want to figure out what I'm supposed to do, too. Because I was getting a little bit miffed and grumbling and complaining and going, I can't stand this anymore. So that's where this was born. That's where this sermon was born. The last one is transgenderism or transsexualism. And that comes from a depraved mind. A depraved mind is not able to make sense. Have you ever seen anybody that's insane? Probably, if you've driven the roads in Colorado. But insanity. Now, I don't make light of anybody that's had emotional issues. I believe those are just as treatable as physical issues, mental issues are, and some people are born with defects of hormones and whatnot, and they need help, and they need tenderness and care. And some people are driven to madness because of the way that they were raised, and I don't point fingers because I've gone through depression. And you shouldn't either, brother Christian or sister Christian. You should try to help as much as you can and point them to Christ and the healing that he can give. So, where are we? We're at the end of the judgments. You go, you telling me that Christ is coming back real quick? I said, I will tell you, sure looks like it to me because of all the way that the world's going. Now listen, this just isn't in Colorado, or this is just isn't in Missouri or Texas, is it? Because I saw all facets of it in Texas, Missouri, and come back to Colorado. You can't run from this stuff. It's everywhere. It's in the world, right? Paris? Okay. So the world is under judgment. Nobody's standing up and saying, "What? We're pulling out, man. You're not doing that." I'd pull my team out. We're not being a part of that. And that's part of what this book is that a lot of these pastors are not preaching the truth because you know why? They want to fill their billfolds. They like the celebrity status. And I've told you many times before from this pulpit that there's some people that you should not listen to, you should not get their books, and I don't care what you think, I'm going to tell you. I want to warn you about the Jezebels, about the heretical people. And there's just a few people that are doing that anymore. They just don't care. They just want to fill this big place up and make people feel good. That's not what this is about. We all need to be checking where we are with the Lord right now. And we will soon see. Now let's just take a cursory look at Romans chapter 1. Most of you know where I'm going with this because you're familiar with Scripture, but it doesn't hurt to do rote. You know what rote is examining the Scriptures over and over and over and over until you learn, until you know. How do you memorize Scripture? It's by rote. You continue and you continue to memorize until you have learned it. Okay? Now let's just go just through this just real quickly. Verse 21, Romans chapter 1. Although they knew God, they neither glorified him as God nor gave thanks to him, but their thinking became futile and their foolish hearts were dark. And listen, you wonder why the young people are not listening today, or even the middle-aged or the older people? Because their hearts are darkened. Their minds are darkened. And let me tell you who's behind that: Satan. And unless they are given light, unless the Lord lifts the blinders off of their hearts and their minds, you're talking to somebody that's like a fence post. They won't listen. I've talked to some young people. I said, you know what? You're going down a wrong road, and you're going to pay a heavy price for this. Oh, what do you know? Who are you? Well, I've lived on this earth 71 years. I've made some pretty big mistakes. And I'm telling you, God's whapped me a few times. And I don't want that to happen to you. I want you to come to know Christ. I want you to get on the right path here. What do you know? That's because their hearts are darkened. Okay? So we don't want to hate sinners. We want to love the sinners, and we hate their sin. We want to bring them to Christ. Because what we're doing is, okay, if somebody belongs to that party, we hate them. Right? Can't even talk. No, we have to talk to them. We have to love these people because it's for such a time as this. Daniel was in Babylon, and Daniel was in a bad place, and Daniel was 13 years old when he went to Babylon, and guess what? He lived there till his late 80s, and he worked for the Lord all his days in a bad place, a very bad place, and God honored his life and used Daniel tremendously. That's who we are. Okay, people claim to be wise. They aren't wise. They're fools. When I saw those people up on that stage mocking the Last Supper, I'm going, I felt sorry for them. They're fools. God could stop your heart right now. He could kill every one of you right now if he wanted to. But he's a God of grace and mercy. He could kill that boxer in the ring. Just like Boom Boom Mancini killed Duke Cao Kim in the ring at Las Vegas. Finished his boxing career. Hit him right in the face, and killed Duke Cao Kim right in the ring in America. It was the end of Boom Boom Mancini's career. He killed this guy. Well, that guy that was fighting this woman, God could have said, this is it for you. You're going to have a brain aneurysm. You're done. But grace and mercy, right? They exchanged the glory of the immortal God for images to look like a mortal human being, and birds and animals and reptiles. Therefore, God gave them over. Now, you must underline that, because God, this is judgment. Now, if you want to play around with sin, if you want to dabble in stuff, God will give you over to it. He'll say, you go ahead and do that, man. You want to play with meth or fentanyl, you do it. You want to play with sex, go ahead, man. Well, why isn't he killing people? He's giving them over to judgment. And their hearts are dark. They can't see. Unless the glorious light of the gospel should shine unto them. Okay, therefore God gave them over to sinful desires of their hearts. To what? Sexual impurity. For the degrading of their bodies with one another. They exchanged the truth about God for a lie. Who's the liar? Who's the father of lies? Satan. He is the father of lies. There's no truth in him. And let me tell you, Satan's behind this. And a lot of other people that Satan is using. And if you read this book, you just go, wow. Because she's not lying about this stuff. She's got some pretty good information coming. Okay, they exchanged the truth about God for a lie and worship and serve created things rather than Almighty God, the Creator, who is forever praised. Amen? We just sang about him. We praise God. Because we're here to praise Jesus Christ, not the church, not the pastor, not the worship team. We're here to praise Jesus. He's the only one that can set us free. Because of this, God gave them over. There's that word again. There's another judgment to shameful lust. Here's homosexuality. Here's the second one that I talked about. For women exchanged mutual sexual relations for unnatural ones, became lesbians. What does this do to the family? It tears it completely apart because there's no mothering anymore. People aren't getting married. People aren't having kids. They're changing everything, exchanging everything for this sinful lifestyle. In the same way, men also abandoned natural relationships with women and were inflamed with lust for one another. You can't procreate from two men. Even my dumb horse knows that. Even my dumb dog knew that. The only way you can procreate with another dog is a male with a female. What has happened? It's insanity. It's called depravity. It's called depraved. So this is judgment. Follow me now. They were inflamed with women and inflamed with lust for one another. Men committed shameful acts with other men and received in themselves the penalty for their error. What was that? AIDS and all kinds of transmitted sexual diseases. All kinds. And from last that I knew, there were way over 100 that you can get. Furthermore, just as they did not think it worthwhile to retain the knowledge of God, I know more about what I want to do. God made a mistake. I'm a man, but I'm going to have a relationship with a man. I'm a woman. I'm going to have a relationship with a woman. God made a huge mistake. Did he? No, they traded it in for the knowledge of what? Themselves. I'm going to be my God. I'm going to run my life. God gave them over to a depraved mind. There it is. There's the third and the last judgment. That's it. That's it. This is where transgenderism takes place. Because we can't even wrap our minds around that. Now, what are we supposed to do to those people? Love them and give them the gospel. Right? Yes. Absolutely so. I feel like they're trapped. There's a demon in there somewhere. I've looked at them. I'm going, dude, this is bad. This is really bad. And it's like you are trapped in a prison. And you know what? When you die, you're going to go to hell because you don't know Christ. It's just horrific. So let's just read a little bit farther. I know you're following me here. So they do what ought not to be done. They have become filled with every kind of wickedness, evil, greed, and there it is again, depravity. It's a loss of senses. It's insane. It's going insane. You have no concept of reality. You know where reality begins? It's with Jesus Christ. Did you know that? When you're in the Word of God, you have a sense of reality, and it calms you down. That's why I remember God's Word. I memorize God's Word. It calms me down. That's why I love to preach, because I know this is good. What I'm doing is what we need, okay? And it's what I need. Okay, greed and depravity, they're full of envy, murder, strife, deceit, malice. They're gossips, slanderers, God-haters, insolent, arrogant, boastful. They invent evil. They disobey their parents. I have never seen such a disobedient generation than this generation. Disrespectful. Somebody told me when I was coaching junior high, don't you dare, Coach Cofer, do this or that. I said, I will do whatever it needs, that child needs, to get my respect. I'll respect him, but if he disrespects me, he's going to hear about it. And I will send his little fanny right out that door. Now, in the old days, you go to the principal's office and he'd lay some wood on your butt. Okay? With holes drilled in the wood. And they got that deal from Oklahoma. I know they did. Because my superintendent was from Oklahoma. And he used it, man. And it was a piece of oak. We don't have oak in Colorado. So that's going to bruise you probably, and then you'll be in prison the rest of your life. But what I'm saying is I've never seen this in such volumes. And it's everywhere, disrespect for people. Well, judgment. Judgment is here. That's what you're seeing, Christian. Now, does that scare you? What's going to happen? What's going to happen to me? Well, if you know the Lord, he's going to help you. Let's turn to Malachi chapter 3. Verse 16. Then those who fear the Lord talk with each other, and the Lord listened and heard. See, we're talking every day. I talk with my best friend about what's going on. He says, I can't believe it. People are insane. Everything's upside down. They're calling good for evil and evil for good. It's just insanity. So we're talking, right? Christians are talking. Wow, okay. It's all right, man. We're going to keep preaching. Those who feared the Lord talked with each other, and the Lord listened and heard. A scroll of remembrance was written in the presence concerning those who feared the Lord and honored his name. On the day when I act, says the Lord Almighty, they will be my treasured possession. I will spare them. Just as a father has compassion and spares his son and serves him. And you will again see the distinction between righteousness and wicked, between those who serve God and those who do not. Don't worry, Christian. Don't worry. You're in the arms of Jesus Christ. Stay the course. Don't give up. Let's turn to Philippians chapter 2. I just have a few minutes. I hope that we can do this. I'm quite aware of the fact that we have communion. Okay? I've been taking Jinkoba. It's really working, man. My mind is much brighter. Okay. Philippians chapter 2 now. I love application. I would guess if someone said, what's your MO as a pastor? I love to read the scriptures and then apply it to life because I believe that there's application. Therefore, in verse 12, my dear friends, as you have always obeyed, not only in my presence, but now much more in my absence, continue to work out your salvation with fear and trembling. Now, what does that have to do with us? Obey the Word of God. Simply, obey the Word of God. But if you don't know the Word of God, how are you going to do that? You know, one of the greatest things that Satan uses is to keep you out of the Word of God? He hates that. He doesn't want you in the Word of God. He doesn't want you coming to know Christ better. He doesn't want you memorizing Scripture. He doesn't want you obeying or applying the Word of God. Aren't we supposed to not just hear the Word of God? Aren't we supposed to obey it? James 1:22. I heard a great message in Missouri at our kids' church in Branson, and I love the pastor. He did a marvelous job, and he was trying to get the congregation to memorize Ephesians chapter 2, verses 8 through 10. And everybody's kind of going, you know what he's trying to do? He's trying to get you engrafted into the Word of God because it's going to help you. And he knows what's going on in this culture. And he's trying to get his people, his flock, ready for war because he loves them. He doesn't want to send them out just like, I went to church. Everybody can go to church. You've got to be engaged, man. You don't come here and just, I hope he's on his game. You take notes and you say, God, this is what I need. This is what I want. I'm so far off. I'm kind of worried about this world. I'm worried about my kids. What do I do? This is what we're doing right now. This is what we're to do. Obey the Word of God is the first one. Okay? Now let's go through this slowly and methodically. Paul is saying the Philippian church, this is the first European church that Paul started, okay, in Europe. Was it easy? No. Philippi was a mess. Philip of Macedon, Philip II of Macedon is the one that founded Philippi. Who is his daddy? Alexander the Great. Alexander the Great. But the Romans did succeed and taking over Philippi eventually. It became a Roman entity, but it was filled with gold and great commerce because it lied right next to a river. So there was all kinds of things happening. So people like that, don't they? They like things. They like nice things. So here, let's go to Philippi. But once Philippi was taken over by the Romans, guess who was occupying it? Soldiers. You know what soldiers are like when they don't have anything to do? Not good. not good. And things happen. Lots of immorality. I'm not saying all soldiers are like that, but I'm telling you, there's a lot of issues in Philippi. And it always is when you're trying to start something for God. If you're preaching the gospel, you're going to get hit right in the face. You got a big target on your back. And I've realized that. I'm okay with that. Because it's God's power that's allowing me to preach to you. This isn't me. This is God's power in and through me, through the Word of God. Therefore, my dear friends, you've always obeyed. But now, much more in my absence, continue to work out your salvation with fear and trembling. What is that? It's sanctification. You and I, when we accepted Christ, are now on this road to become more like Christ. That's why you're having trials. That's why you have problems. That's why you're tempted and tested beyond what you think you can even bear. Satan hates you. He wants to take you out, man. Your family, everybody wants to take this church out. Do anything you can. So you've got to participate in the process of sanctification. Don't say, God, this is too hard. I'm not doing this. I'm out of here. No. Look and see in your Bible where it says trials are a benefit to us. Look and see. My sister lost a child to a murderer. And she said, I could not have made it had I not realized that God is sovereign. She recognized the sovereignty of God. God took her child. Other than that, she would have pulled the trigger and blown her brains out. Now, I'm serious. I'm telling you that because that's what she told me. Participate. Say, God, this hurts. I don't know why I'm going through this, but you do. I'm going to participate with you. I'm going to get into the Word of God. I'm going to let it just bleed through my veins, my arteries. I'm going to know Scripture. I want to know you. And you're going to take my life, and I'm going to submit to you. And you're going to turn me around and transform me so that I can be used in this dark world. Number two, fear the Lord. You say, I don't like that word. You better like that word. There's a lack of fear and reverence for Almighty God. God is not the man upstairs, my good old buddy. He is God Almighty. He's the one that breathed breath into your little lungs when you came forth out of your mother's womb. He's the one that gave you life in your mommy's tummy. He gave us life. What does that mean? We're to reverence Him. We're to walk with Him in fear in that if I walk this sinful path, if I walk away from God or my family, if I make this choice, what might happen to me? Discipline. Discipline. The rod of discipline. Didn't God say that He took many out of the Corinth church because they ate the supper, came to the communion table, drunk, having debauchery in their midst, having sex with other people, being angry at other people, and they come and they just blaspheme God and His name. So what does it say? He took some of them out. Many of them were asleep. He took them home. He killed them. That's God. You say, whoa, that's fear. That's reverential fear. God could do that to me. He could do that to you. Walk with the Lord. Walk with the Lord. Know His peace and His comfort. Don't know His chastening. You don't want to know His discipline. Although He does discipline us, even in some loving situations, to make us grow. Proverbs 9:10, the fear of the Lord, that's the beginning of wisdom. You better fear God. Okay? Let's go on. How much time do I have? Not much. Okay. For it is God who works in you to will and act in order to fulfill His good purpose. Nobody stands up here. Paul didn't stand in the pulpit or on the street corner in his own power. Anybody that is preaching or teaching or witnessing, that's any of us, Christian, hear me. That's God's power. I just talked to a gentleman before the service. He said, I've had many opportunities to witness. Many. About family and about marriage. Don't tell me that's not God ordained. It is. But my friend knows it's not him. It's God's power. See, you don't want to listen to some preacher that's trying to mesmerize you with a Greek and a Hebrew. Although that's not wrong. I don't get me wrong. I think you should be well-educated and have some oratorical skills, if you will. But you better be filled with the Spirit. This is not fun and games. This is serious. People's lives are in peril. Your eternal destiny is in peril. Do you know that? Do you look at people as a spiritual person or just some person that's in your way? They're all spiritual, and they're going to spend eternity in heaven or hell. Okay? So, 3, don't grumble. Do everything without grumbling or arguing. We're the most affluent society in the world. This Western world is more affluent. Even the poor people have more than enough. Did you not know that? And what do we want? More. More and more and more. And you know what? More never satisfies. It's going to turn gravel in your mouth. I thought, you know, I'd sure like to have that nice sports Audi, that car, you know. I think I saw Tony Romo going through Dallas. I'm just kidding. We were at a standstill in Dallas, Texas, okay? And I could hear this roar. And here comes this beautiful sports car. It was an Audi. I can't remember the name of it. I told Cheryl, I'd like to have that. She says, why? So you can get in trouble? So you can be in jail? You know? And I know if I got that car, it wouldn't make me happy. It wouldn't. It wouldn't make me happy. We have become narcissists. We have become narcissists. It's all about me. I'm going to do what makes me feel good. To heck with the rest of the people. You know what God does to grumblers? You can look at Numbers 11:1 later on. He does not like grumbling, and he will kill us. He'll kill you. I'm sick of your stinking grumbling. I've given you everything you could possibly have. Health, a good family. Even if you're poor, I've given you food and clothing and a place to worship, friends, family. What more could you ask? And then we just start grumbling. And I tell you, I think we're ruining our younger generation because I was given a lot, but the next generation was given a lot, and this generation coming up, unbelievable. And you know something? It's not making them happy. You want to get a lakefront property, Table Rock Lake in Branson, Missouri? You go for it. You can spend about $2.7 million and you'll get you one of those things. I'll guarantee you it won't make you happy. And you'll start grumbling. And one day, you know what's going to happen to you? Boom! The coroner is going to come knocking on that beautiful 17,000 square foot home. They're going to pick up your carcass, send it to the funeral home, pump it full of formaldehyde, make you look the best you've ever looked, and put you in a hole. Yep. You're not taking nothing with you. Yep. You might take your Rolex. Wife says, I'll leave that Rolex on. It looks really good. It's going to rot, man. Might as well take it and sell it. That was a joke. Okay. Anyway, 3, don't grumble. Give thanks in all circumstances. 1 Thessalonians 5:18. And that goes for all of us. I'm included in this. Because I'm not very thankful at times. 4, we're to be a light, we're to be a witness in this world. Okay? Because we're talking about what should we do with this situation, right? Okay, be a light. So that you can be blameless and pure, children of God without fault in a warped and crooked generation. Then you'll shine among them like stars in the heaven. Let your light so shine among men that they may glorify your Father in heaven. Let your light shine. Talk to people. Be kind to people. When the luggage compartment is open in the plane and this little old lady can't get her bag that weighs way too much, you go up there and you help her. You don't go, doggone, get out of the way. And I've seen that happen. Crooked. Scoliosis. Ever seen somebody with scoliosis? I had a cousin who had scoliosis, and they corrected her curvature of the spine by an operation. And he's twisted. Twisted. We live in a twisted generation. Depraved. Insane. twisted. And you go, well, now I kind of understand, Pastor Rick. But this is what we're supposed to do. Be a light. Be a witness. Don't give up. Don't shoot them with a potato gun. Don't flip your finger at them going down the highway and then honk because you got a deal on your back of the car. Honk, Jesus loves you. And they go, that guy just flipped me off, you know. That's a real good thing, isn't it, for the church? Not too good. 5, spread the word of God. As you hold firmly the word of life, to the word of life, not a real good translation there. You should hold out the word of life. You should spread the gospel wherever you can. You ever go to the beauty salon, ladies? I'm not trying to make fun. Have you ever been in the beauty salon? Okay. You ever talk to your hairdresser? Do you know if she's a Christian or not? Okay. Men, you ever go get your car worked on or go someplace, you know, golfing, whatever? You ever talk to anybody about Christ? Or you see a lead in there, you know, hey, I think he's pushing me to witness to somebody. Or you've got a captive witness when you're on an airplane. Can't get off, you know, and you feel God is moving. Hey, have you read this good book right here, you know? Well, what's that all about, you know? And you just start talking. See what the Holy Spirit does. We are docile, and we're afraid. Don't be. Be bold for such a time as this. That's why we're here. We're not here just to get some more stuff. Cheryl and I are trying to get rid of stuff. You guys want any stuff? We got stuff at home, and we'll give you the stuff, free stuff, okay? Let's go on. And then I will be able to boast on the day of Christ that I did not run or labor in vain. The last 2, 6 and 7. Be involved in the church, be involved in Christian work and ministry. That's all of us. And just being in church doesn't mean, okay, now I've done my... No, it means when you leave this place, then you get involved wherever you are. You know, if you live in Ramo or Ellicott or Colorado Springs or Falcon, you get involved wherever God has got you, okay? And that's Hebrews 10, 24 and 25. 7, the last point, don't give up. Don't give up. And that's where I was going. It's like, I'm so tired of this. I usually really watch the Olympics. I like the Olympics a lot. And I just don't want to watch it. Not everybody is into this stuff, okay? I'm just telling you what I'm going through. I'm not telling you to do that. I'm just telling you how this has affected me. And that's where this message was born. A lot of people think, well, I'm just going to live my Christian life in isolation. Doesn't work. I need you guys. I felt instant love and acceptance when I came into this room. I need you. And you need me. We need each other. Be involved. Some people right now are just about on the precipice of giving up. Say, I can't take this anymore. But if you're not involved, how are you going to know? You just, you know, just walk past people. You know, I don't want to get involved because if I do, that means I'm going to get my hands dirty. I might have to do something for somebody, or I might have to, you know, that's not what Christianity is. And if people see us getting involved and loving one another like Christ did, they're going to see the reality of Christ in us, the hope of glory. Colossians 1:27. That's what this is all about. So when I'm traveling, I'm trying to be more cognizant of the people around me and try to be kind to them. Trying to be Christ-like to them. So there it is. That's the evening news or the morning news. Obey the word of God, memorize it, obey God, apply it. Fear the Lord. That's the beginning of wisdom. Don't grumble. Give thanks. Be a light. Be a witness. Spread the word of God. Be active. Be involved. Get involved in your local church, in the community, in the places where you are. Be involved. Start talking to people. Have you ever invited anyone to church? What do you think they do? Punch you out? All right, they might. They might. Don't give up. Don't throw the white towel in. You know, Roberto Duran was one of my favorite boxers. And you know what one of his famous lines was? No mas. No mas, man. Don't want no more. I think he was one of the best boxers ever lived, really, you know. He just gave up, and he didn't have anybody, to give him a boost. We do. We've got our brothers and sisters in Christ right here, gives a boost. Okay, so you can take that for what it's worth. I hope you took some notes. I'm going to study that more, and I'm going to see what God does. We have communion with us today. You're surprised I remembered that. The people that are giving out communion, would you please come forward? And I want to give you a chance right now to prepare your hearts for communion, because this isn't a liturgical mindset. This isn't something that, yeah, we do and we don't think about it. I don't know how your week was. I don't know what's going on in your heart, your life. But God knows, and he wants you to talk to him. Don't come to the table real flippant and angry and mad. Deal with some of that stuff right where you sit. God is able to handle that. Get with somebody this week that you know loves the Lord Jesus and meet with them. Start growing in Christ, discipling, disciple making. Because you don't want to come to the table where all these sinful attitudes and platitudes have engrafted into your heart so much that you don't even know what you're doing here. God wants you to get serious about what he's talking about in your life and in your heart. Because you can fool me, and I can fool you. Can't we? We can walk in, put on the old plastic face, man. Everything's cool, when it's not. So let's just do business with the Lord, and perhaps you can tell somebody about what's happening in your life, and they can help you. Let's just take some time to talk to the Lord about our lives and take this very seriously, because it's a serious time. And Father God, I love that name, Father. It just gives me a picture where I climb up into your lap and you're holding me and I'm revealing to you everything that's in my heart. Sometimes the tears are falling. Sometimes I'm very upset with the way I live my life this week or have been living my life, and I confess to you my sins, and you're so willing and ready to forgive and to comfort and console. That's when we're repentant and we're humble. But when we're not, when we come to the table arrogant or come to you in an arrogant manner, in an unrepentant way, you're going to let us have what we want. And it's going to be devastating. I pray, Lord, that there'd be transformation in every heart here, and in particular mine. Paul said that he was the chief of sinners. I like that. He was very transparent. He was just a man called on a mission just like we are. Father, help us to build relationships that are real, loving relationships where we can let go and talk about things that we desperately need to talk about in confidence, of course, as we take a Hippocratic oath and are sworn not to reveal those things. But we need each other. We can't live in isolation. Father, we love you as we commemorate your life, your death, and your resurrection, and now your intercessory prayer that's going on our behalf right now, and soon you will come back for us at the rapture. We love you. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Thank you. Lord, we truly fear you, and we reverence you. We love you, and we want to obey you. And we just want to say from the depths of our heart that we want to serve you. We want to submit our lives to you. And whatever way you want to use us, I pray that you'd use this congregation in a mighty way. Let's partake together. Don't quit. Don't give up. Eric Little was in the 1924 Paris Olympics. And because of his convictions, he did not run his race on Sunday, which was the 100 meter. So he ran the 400 meter the next week, during the week. And one of the massage therapists gave him a note before he got into the blocks for the 400 meter in 1924 in Paris. Said, God honors those who honor him, and gave him that note. It just gives me chills. I talk about Eric Little quite a bit because he's a real deal. He went on to be a missionary in China. That's what he wanted to be. He died in a Japanese prisoner of war camp, civilian war camp, at the age of 43. Didn't get a chance to live a long time, did he? But let me tell you, he served the Lord. He completed his mission. Don't ever think that you can't be used to God. Don't ever think that. Don't let Satan keep you out of the game. We all need to be in the game, all of us. So I want you to get a biography of Eric Little. It's not going to cost you a lot. Eric Little, he's from Scotland. He ran for the British Empire, but he was from Scotland, 1924. Also, Chariots of Fire, Academy Award winning, Chariots of Fire. If you've never watched that movie, you should get it. Why am I telling you these things? It'll lift your spirits. And you know what? We need to be strong for the Lord, just like Eric Little was. He was strong for the Lord. And he would not let anyone take him down. Let's thank the Lord for his shed blood, because without it, we would have no forgiveness of sins, and we would have eternity in hell to look forward to. But because of his sacrifice, because of his grace and mercy, we can have eternal life in heaven forever. Let's thank him for that. Father, thank you for this wonderful group of people that I love. And I am very privileged to be here, to be their pastor, and I'm very privileged to serve alongside them. We all serve together with our different gifts. None is more important than the other. But there's a great deal of love here, and that's because you're here, Jesus. Lord, just unleash your spirit that's in us. This week, just start the transforming process, Father. Don't let us be afraid. Help us not to give up. In Jesus' name I pray, and all of God's children say, amen. You're dismissed.